Okay, folks, we are back. I know the name of the show is Howling After Dark, and the name of the episode is Residential EVP, but I'm going to do something a little bit different right now. I'm going to kind of explain to some of my new listeners who I am, what my background is, and why and how I do what I do. This all started for me when I was 5 years old. I had a near-death experience. Ever since then, I can see them. I don't hear them. In fact, I don't hear them to the point where I actually learned how to read lips, because they would come up and try and talk to me once they figured out I could see them. But I don't. I don't hear them unless it's like a disembodied voice that like pretty much anybody can hear. And I hear pretty good on EVPs. But like in the moment, without the aid of some kind of device or something, I don't hear them. So there's that. Also, for a good chunk of my life now, I've been a paranormal investigator and kind of goes hand in hand, a shaman or medicine man. I do house cleansings, and to kind of illuminate what that actually means, because some people think that all you do is go into a house and burn some sage and or maybe throw some salt around and that's good enough, and that's absolutely not the truth. The reason why I've done 430 plus house cleansings to date without ever having to do a return visit is very simple. It's not the sage, it's not the salt, it's not any superpower of mine. It's very, very simple. The reason it works is because I actually believe it. I have absolute faith in it. And it doesn't hurt that I am from an actual Native American background and we're the ones that use sage for stuff like this. Everybody else has just kind of adopted it. But I digress. So what I do is, first off, I come in and I investigate, and the reason we investigate first all the time, every time, is very simple. Number one, if there is something negative, we want to know exactly what kind of negative we're dealing with. And number two, and actually about 8 times out of 10, this happens more often. We want to establish if, in fact, there's anything negative at all in the house. Because most of the time, what we deal with actually isn't even negative at all. It's misunderstood. It's just moving stuff around or you know, pushing its limits because it's trying to get somebody's attention. Because spirits, that's what they want. They actually want to communicate. And it's really not like it is on TV shows. If you're a paranormal investigator and you provoke, you're a fucking idiot. And yes, I just dropped an F-bomb. But there you have it. Flat out the truth. You're an idiot if you've ever done that. Because you've seen it on TV and think you know what to do. That is not what to do. Two things. I'm a historical investigator, meaning that I actually use the history to fashion my questions. So I know what to ask. And not only that, I can find inconsistencies that way with the history. things just to give you an example, if I were to visit the grave of, let's say, Doc Holliday, for example, and I were to say, is it true that at the OK Corral you used a shotgun? That would be a good question to ask, because I'm not just assuming that that's what happened. I'm letting the spirit answer for themselves whether or not that's how it went down. Really, the only time anybody should ever provoke is when there is no doubt in your mind at all whatsoever, and it's backed up by evidence and everything else, that what in fact you're dealing with is evil. That is the only time provoking should ever be done. And the reason that is the only time it should be done is because they feed on fear. If you show them none, they have nothing to feed on, which helps you get rid of them because they don't hold on as tight. So, anyways, we investigate, we make sure that what we're dealing with is actually something negative before I do house cleansing. That's in general. And the reason we do it that way is because I do not remove good spirits. I tell clients this every time. If there are good spirits in this house, they're still going to be here. Anything evil, anything negative is leaving as of right now. And I say it pretty much just like that. And the reason I say it like that is because I want to assure them that I have that confidence in myself and in my abilities and what I have faith in. Which, by the way, isn't any form of Christianity. Not that I'm opposed to Christians or Christianity as a whole. I am opposed to those that are so closed-minded that they don't have room for anything else or any other kind of idea. That kind of closed-mindedness is always going to bug me, though. And I actually preach about closed-mindedness a lot on this show. Because if you have a closed mind, you have a closed heart, too. And that's just all sorts of BS. But anyways, so we establish that. Once that's established and our investigation is done, I take out my sage, I light it, of course, and I go through the entire house, and I say the same thing over and over again through the entire house. It's kind of a prayer or a mantra, even, that I have absolute faith in. I say, Uniqua, creator of all worlds, grant us your blessings and protect us from evil. And I say that over and over again. Uniqua, by the way, is the Cherokee word for the Great Spirit, what Christians would call God, which in my book is actually the same thing, so all the fighting is for nothing. So that's what I do. I go through the house and I do that, and it works, and it has worked 430 some odd times because I have faith in it. If you don't have faith in sage smoke, don't use sage. Use whatever it is that you have that kind of faith in. And if you don't have that kind of faith in anything, then you should not be doing house cleansings, period. And you certainly shouldn't be doing it for money, because anybody that charges for house cleansing has a problem. And his name's Ghost Wolf J, and he has this show, because that is like a public service. You shouldn't get paid for that. The only money you should ever receive for that kind of thing, maybe, is if it's a long distance away from you, and you need money for gas, or if it's like a huge business and you need money for materials. That's it. I'd never charge for a residential case. The only time I've ever gotten money from a residential case went right into the gas tank. And that's because they were so far away. They were, like, I live in Barberton, which is right outside of Akron, Ohio. And they lived in Athens, Ohio, which is clear, like, on the other side of the state, like, over 5 hours away. And I've said it before, but I'll say it again. In the paranormal world, in the paranormal community, we have to be so careful about what we do, because if we're acting a fool, we're doing things we shouldn't be doing, or you know, treating people in a negative way that, as a client, that reflects on the people that come after you. You know, it reflects on everybody else in our community. So if, for example, and I've had some experience with this, and actually ended up sort of leaving a team because of this, an individual who I'm not going to name, I found out was stealing proceeds from hosted ghost hunts. And that the deal that we had set up when I was on that team was that we would charge, you know, X amount, let's say like $20 per person. So out of each $20, we would get 10, and then that money would get split up amongst the members of the team for gas and expenses and whatnot. And I don't have a problem with that. Money for a hosted ghost hunt is a different thing than money for, like, a residential case. Okay? But I found out this guy was stealing basically our half of the proceeds and more. Yeah, because he's technically overcharging people. But I found out about it, and I raised a big stink about it, and the reaction I got was so not the one I expected. And I kind of quit, but it was basically forced, I guess you could say. Or I felt like I didn't have a choice, let's put it like that. So I left them and founded Ghost Love Paranormal. And in many ways, it's kind of the best thing that's ever fucking happened to me. And yeah, by the way, I apologize to those that don't like cussing that might be listening to my show. I cuss. I cuss like a sailor and a trucker had a bastard child, and it grew up to be me. But I'm actually trying to be good tonight, so bear with me. So yeah, that's basically what I do in that role in particular. The other thing that we do is we try and find out as much information about the property as we can before we actually start investigating. And there's actually a few ways that are really easy to find out information. And a lot of people complain about, well, I tried to do research, but I couldn't find any history on it. Bullshit. It's called Google. trust me, Google has everything you need to find anything. I found that hidden histories on well-known haunted places. I found hidden histories that weren't even discovered yet by using online media and whatnot. Google and Bing and whatever search engines, and it's just a matter of knowing where to look. Any kind of historical archive is going to be a big bonus, and there are tons of sites for those. Some of them even have pictures, so you can match, like a house, for example, with the history, because it'll look the same, basically. A lot of them do change over the years because of remodeling and whatnot, but the basics of a place aren't going to change all that much. Like, for example, one of the things I found out actually was about Brown Ella Cottage. That's in Galleon, Ohio. It was built for Bishop William Brown and his wife, Ella. And it was paid for by his mother-in-law, Ella's mom, Mary. And interestingly enough, we knew that the bishop, who was a Lutheran bishop, by the way, was the last man in modern time to be convicted of heresy. Because his wife died and he went off the deep end and got involved in, like, communism and Darwinism and all this other stuff that the church frowned on. And he really did go off the deep end, though. He even wrote a children's book called Communism for Boys and Girls. I'm not kidding. They actually have boxes of those books up in the attic. But fantastic location. But one of the things I found out is that whether it was ever completed or not, there was an intent at one point, because of harsh winter weather, to build a tunnel system from the basement to the church, which was across the street. And if you don't know how to find stuff out, by all means, contact me. I will tell you how to find stuff. But if I do, it's going to be under the understanding that if I give you access to historical databases, etc., etc., if I help you out in that way, you will not provoke ever. So, to all my listeners out there, that's the deal. You want help finding history, never provoke. Only exception to that rule is if you absolutely know that you're dealing with evil, then okay. But just because you're in a prison or an insane asylum, don't assume that it's evil. Actually know it because you've investigated it. I don't ever want to hear, like, oh, I know it's evil because I had these cold chills. Well, every spirit gives you those. Oh, by the way, just a little announcement. Y'all can check this out. Actually, let me bring up the site and I'll post it. I have been invited to be a guest on a nationally syndicated radio show. And it's not just online radio, it's actually goes out over radio, over airwaves. It's called X Zone Radio. I've been invited to be a guest on their show for April 21st at 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. But I'm posting this in Ghost Wolf Radio. But anywho, Nicole says that she usually starts with historicmapworks.com, so that's a good site for you. Anywho, so yeah, and there's tons of sites like that. I've actually used that one myself. There was another one called Archives with a Z. .net, I think. It's .net or .org. I can't remember which one. But also post this on Facebook. Anyways, let's see how much time. Okay, got about 15 minutes left. I'm going to go ahead and play a few more EVPs. Yes, this one is actually from Brown Ella. I'm just going to play it one time and then we'll listen to it again and then I'll tell you what I hear. Okay, there's a male voice there. I'm not going to say what I know it says. I actually hear this one really super clear. I'm going to tell you what it says, but I'm going to play it one more time. But it is a male voice, and it's right after I say, "Do you not like me putting this on your bed?" We were at Brown Ella Cottage. We were in Ella's room. And I'd set my EM detector on the bed. Or it might have been my digital recorder. I don't remember which one. But anyways, here we go. Okay, I'm going to tell you what I hear, and I'm going to tell you why it was funny when I reviewed this. What I hear is, I say, do you like me putting this by your bed? And then I hear this male voice, who I'm kind of assuming is the bishop. And he says, "Now give me bread." Now, why that was kind of funny at the time is, knowing his history with, you know, being convicted of heresy and getting involved in like Darwinism and communism and all this other stuff, it was almost as if he were kind of mocking communion a little bit, I think. That's my theory anyways. I don't know for sure. There's nothing associated with communion in the room, but, you know, there you go. Anyways, I'm going to play this one more time. Okay, this next one is what is now one of my favorite places. I've only gotten to investigate there once, but I'm dying to go back. It's located in Akron. It's the Glendale Cemetery. And, well, I'll just let you hear it. Okay, I'm pausing it because I just heard something I did not hear before. So I'm backing this up a little bit. I just heard laughter. Now, I can't say it's definitively paranormal because we were not the only team there that night. It was an event hosted at Glendale Cemetery in Akron to raise money to repair this beautiful bell tower that's there, and it was a great event. There was probably about 300 people total, but we all spread out all over the cemetery, and it's huge. It's like 28 acres. So it is possible that could have been a human person laughing. I don't know, but I think it's interesting that I did not notice it before. So here we go. Yeah, it was right there. It's like, all right, let me play it one more time. You know what I think we'll do?
What? Sorry.
I was just thinking about this. Whenever we, like tomorrow or something, I'll come over and grab that camera and upload the footage to my computer.
Okay.
Direct. That way you don't have to send it to me.
Okay.
And then, you know, I'll just bring it back. That?
Where?
Heard something. Sounded like a voice over a PA system.
That's what
like
I heard.
Like an actual
too.
Sound.
Yeah, that's what I heard too.
I'm just thinking about contamination and stuff.
Understandable.
Well, this is pretty close to the road.
Yeah.
So I want to kind of cycle back this way.
Okay.
Sorry that I'm sitting on you.
Okay, Flash.
Now, there is no electricity here. So, aside from my devices, I shouldn't be picking up any EM at all, and it's not.
I think I got something, but it has to be on the first frame. I'm happy to let the music rest. Section P, still too low.
Well, late 1800s.
1800s.
But this stone looks a lot older.
Yeah, I can't quite make it out. This is a soldier, definitely. 115th Ohio Infantry.
Oh, wow.
Company B. UB Purdy.
This is Lester's. No, yeah, no, this is a friend.
Kind of squat next to you. You're good. You said you're good. Squat next to you. You're good. You said you're good. Well, thank
I'm
you, sir.
Beat your feet.
Can you tell me what your rank was? Sergeant? Did you say sergeant? What war were you in, sir?
He said West Point.
He said West Point. Were you a lieutenant or a sergeant?
All right, folks. We found out later that it was indeed Lieutenant U.B. Purdy of the 115th Ohio Infantry Regiment during the Civil War. But that is about all the time I've got. It got exactly 30 seconds now. I want to thank you all for tuning in. Don't forget to tune in Sunday night. It'll be at 8 and then Monday at 11 for more Howling After Dark. Until next time, my pack, my tribe. Peace out.